Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. You know, one of the reasons why I'm so fascinated with Bordeaux, and I can't wait to go visit that place with Kosher Riverboat Cruises this year, is because Bordeaux is right at the very beating heart of the changes that affected the Jewish community of Europe and brought them into modernity at the turn of the 19th century. I'm speaking specifically about the movement towards emancipation, which occurs primarily in Paris. That's where most of the debates and discussions were held, and the Grand Sanhedrin, which I'll talk about in a second, was convened and so on. But, you know, the transition from pre-modern state, from really a medieval state, to a modern state is so crucial for the development of modern Jewry all around the world. And in many ways, American Jews, Canadian Jews, Australian Jews, we all have to look back to what happened in Paris and in Bordeaux in those few decades that traversed the turn of the 19th century to really understand how did we get to where we are right now. So let's just think about this for a second. What do I mean by this emancipation, this change to modernity? The term emancipation is kind of a weird term that was decided upon, you know, towards the end of the 19th, early 20th century by Jewish historians to try to describe the shift from pre-modernity to modernity. It's not precisely the right term. It's a term that was borrowed primarily from the American context with the emancipation of the African slaves in America, which of course happened in the 1860s in the context of the American Civil War. The Jews of Europe were not enslaved, but they clearly were of a much lower status. They had all kinds of legal disabilities, residence restrictions. Lots of institutions were closed to them, like universities and so on. And really, the only way to get ahead was to leave Jewry altogether and to convert to Christianity, because in the pre-modern era, these states did not really have a conception of a secular identity possible for all citizens. Again, that term is also unusual for the term within a given state. And so the transition from this kind of like legally disabled status to equal status with other citizens is really the seam of modernity for Jewry. And it happened on a very sharp date, 1789, with the French Revolution, as we shall discuss. Now, the reason why it's not precisely the same as emancipation is because they weren't enslaved. I mean, within limits, they had freedom. They could not move anywhere they wanted. They could not even have as many children as they wanted, the familial laws and so on, all kinds of special restrictions on them. But nevertheless, within those contexts, they did have freedom. This is not the case, obviously, with the African American slaves in America who were enslaved in many ways far worse than they had been in ancient times. It's not even like a comparable type of emancipation, which happens right around the same time, the emancipation of the serfs of the Russian Empire. Like the African Americans, the serfs of Russia were also emancipated, thank you very much, freedom of movement, things like that, but they were not given any resources to actually take advantage of that emancipation. So a lot of the things that were actually their supports in the pre-modern era, like the fact that they did have certain privileges on the land, those things all disappeared, and now all of a sudden they were expected to pay rent for their keep. And that meant that, you know, if they weren't producing quite enough in their agricultural output, they had to find other sources of income, which led to the slowly burgeoning industrialization of Russia, which took much longer than it did in Western Europe. And it led to the decrease of the population in the rural centers and movement to urban centers, lots of major changes. These are not the same things that affected Jewry, and especially French Jewry. So let's go very quickly to what happened in the French Revolution and how it affected Bordeaux and Parisian Jewry, and then later, you know, Jews all around the world. If we look at this key document here, this is the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of Citizen that was passed by the National Assembly in August of 1789, immediately after the French Revolution. And this is like a really important document in the history of the world. It basically declares the same kinds of things that you see in the American Constitution, the Bill of Rights, things like that, a fundamental commitment to equality of all citizens living within the realm. Now, this was a massive shift from the pre-modern period, because in that time, There was not equality. You had nobility, high ranks. You had the clergy, you had their own little box. You had the peasants. You had the burghers living in the cities and in villages and so on. And there were all kinds of different rights and privileges. And we saw this not only with the Jews as an entire corporation, as an entire class, but even within Jewish communities. We've spoken in the past about the distinctions between the Sephardic communities, who were primarily located in the area of Bordeaux. You can see in this map here, towards the southwest, as very distinct from the population of Ashkenazim, who were primarily in the northeast. Huge distinctions within the Jewish community, and especially between Jews and non-Jews, and all of that was thrown out the window, theoretically, with the French Revolution. When they promulgated this document, you know, a lot of Jews, and incidentally women, said, hey, that includes us, right? And all of a sudden, the authors of the document said, well, wait a second, we weren't necessarily thinking quite that broadly to include Jews as citizens, women as citizens, wait a second. So they put the brakes on that, but they couldn't put the brakes on it forever. So by 1790, they had made the decision, okay, the Sephardic Jews of Bordeaux, they're French-speaking, they're fairly well assimilated or acculturated to French norms, we'll give them citizenship. The Ashkenazi Jews, it took another year, but by 1791, they were fully emancipated. Now, with this emancipation, there were lots of tensions, and the tensions really lasted for two decades. As, you know, these Jews who had been, you know, pent up with all kinds of artificial restrictions, suddenly found that they had an open and level playing field in all kinds of areas where they already had natural and cultural strengths. Like, for example, a long, long tradition of literacy and numeracy, a long familiarity with financial endeavors, primarily because of the prohibitions on owning land and the discouragements of owning land and various other being barred from trades and things like that. So they had developed quite a bit of expertise in all kinds of fields that were especially useful to modern and growing economies. And this provoked a lot of backlash from local populations who said, wait a second, the Jews are taking over. So by the 1800s, this level of complaint from the non-Jewish residents who felt that, especially in the Ashkenazic lands, they were being taken advantage of by Jews who were now equal citizens, which was something that was deeply resented, they eventually went to Napoleon and they said, Napoleon, you got to figure this out for us. Napoleon, in his characteristically large way of thinking, said, okay, fine. Have you got a representative body of Jews that we can consult to find out exactly what do they think about this new experiment? And his advisor said, well, there is this thing called the Sanhedrin, but it hasn't met since ancient times. He says, fine, let's bring out the Sanhedrin. And so he assembled a massively enthusiastic group of Jews from all over Napoleonic Europe to come together in Paris and to answer a few questions that Napoleon had for the Jews. And he posed it to the Sanhedrin saying, okay, you guys speak for the entire body of world Jewry. Obviously, the Jews themselves had differing opinions as to the authority of the Sanhedrin, but they did have a very important figure at its head, the respected Talmudic scholar Rabbi David Sinsheim, who, as you can see here, he was given this amazing hat to serve as the president of the Sanhedrin. I have never seen anyone wearing a hat quite like this. I personally would love one. I think it would be great if I showed up in shul wearing one of these. But at any rate, the Sanhedrin, which had a lot of controversies behind it, obviously in this short video, I don't want to go into great detail about it, but ultimately the Assembly of Notables, which was the predecessor of the Sanhedrin proper, had 12 questions posed to it by Napoleon. And these are they. First of all, do Jews believe in polygamy? Are Jews allowed to marry more than one wife? And that was a pretty easy question for the Jews to answer. I think it's more interesting to think about why is Napoleon asking this question in the first place. I think the reason is probably because he wanted to kind of assess, and he wanted the Jews to sort of reflect on just how prepared are Jews to accommodate themselves to French realities. Now, in the Jewish tradition, of course, if you have any familiarity with the Bible, as Napoleon would have, he would know that Abraham had two wives, that Jacob had four wives, and so on. And he was wondering, like, what are Jews doing today? It's interesting to note the degree of his ignorance of the Jewish community, because since the year 1000, more or less, the Jewish community of Europe, the Ashkenazim in particular, had already banned polygamy, and it disappeared for like 800 years by that point. Polygamy was still practiced in African Jewish communities and Middle Eastern Jewish communities, but not at all in European Jewish communities. So they could simply say with confidence, no, no polygamy. And then he asked a question about divorce. Of course, the Catholic Church did not permit divorce. They had something called annulment, which has some common features, but he wanted to know how close were the Jews to this idea. Jews do permit divorce. He asked about, do Jews intermarry with non-Jews? That was probably one of the questions that the Sanhedrin had the most difficulty answering straight up. And they basically kind of fudged the answer and said, well, you know, wow, look at the time, it's already, and tried to really distract Napoleon's representatives from the answer, which is that basically Judaism forbids intermarriage, but if it happens, the Jews and the Jewish community don't really have a lot of tools to prevent it. And of course, this was important to Napoleon because he's thinking, okay, how long am I going to have this problem? How long am I going to have this inassimilable mass of people living in France who don't necessarily regard themselves as French? So then he goes to the heart of the question, are Frenchmen considered brethren or strangers? Excuse me, the Assembly of Notables knew what kind of answer he wanted. He said, of course we consider Frenchmen our brothers, not strangers. Is there a double standard? Same kind of question. They said, no, no. Do Jews born in France consider this their country? Will they defend it? Will they obey its laws? This is especially important because the Ashkenazi Jews live right up against Germany, where there are a lot more Ashkenazi Jews as well. What would happen if France went to war with Germany, which they did with some regularity? So would French Jews side with France or join with Ashkenazi Jews in Germany? He's very concerned about this. Then he delves into the last six questions, which really focus on how do the Jews organize themselves. Like question seven is, who appoints the rabbis? And do rabbis have police? And nine, are Jews bound to obey the rabbis? Meaning Napoleon wants to know, am I setting myself up to have a state within a state where the Jews have their own legal system and police system and they'll manage themselves? What happens if their laws don't correspond to French laws? What are we going to do about that? So the rabbis, you know, this is really where you see a lot of the break between pre-modernity, where the Jews essentially did have their own legal system and they did have their own enforcement system, which was typically supported by the state. But in France, in a modern citizen-based democracy, you can't have two different legal systems, two different police systems for different populations. The police is for everybody, the law is for everybody, and so on. So they found answers that satisfy Napoleon. Then he asked some economic questions about, are Jews required to engage in usury, which is, of course, kind of like the negative term for money lending? Are Jews forced to engage in that? What happens if they want to pursue a different occupation, like, I don't know, medicine or accounting or, I don't know, ping pong, whatever it is? And of course, they gave the answers, yes, Jews are free to pursue all kinds of occupations as long as there are no barriers set up for them and so on. The bottom line of all these questions was he wanted to know, are you prepared to become French citizens and take on for yourselves the burdens of equality? Or do you want to try and retain some kind of distinctiveness within our society that would be unacceptable to our way of life? That's essentially the gist of it. The Jews of the Sanhedrin and its predecessor, really the Assembly of Notables, when these first questions were posed, they answered, yes, we want equality. We will, you know, figure out how to deal with the ways in which Jewish particularism does not fit with universalism. We want into this society as a whole. And those decisions were essentially the ones that affected modern Jewry for the next 250 odd years. Now, it's really interesting to try and think back on what was the thinking of the Jews when they gave these answers. And it's, you know, did they give the right answers? Did they sacrifice too much, perhaps? The enthusiasm with Napoleon's support was so significant. They were soon disappointed by some of the decisions he laid out later, which reimposed certain restrictions on them. But if you want to get a sense for the somewhat slavish admiration that many of these Jews had for modernity. Again, not shared universally. Many of the Jews in Eastern Europe were quite hesitant to endorse this venture. But have a look at this remarkable medallion, which was coined by the Jewish community to specifically celebrate the achievements of Napoleon Sanhedrin. On the left, of course, you see the profile of Napoleon himself. It says in French, the emperor and king. And then on the right, you see Napoleon actually delivering the Ten Commandments to an obsequious genuflecting Jew, which essentially is placing Napoleon in the position of Moses. I mean, what a mind-boggling piece of coinage, right? Wow. That's a quick talk on this. There's so much more to say about it, but I don't want to take too much of your time. I really appreciate your watching, and I hope some of you will be able to join us on this cruise. And if not, I'm really looking forward to sharing some of the things I see while I'm there in Bordeaux this year. Thank you very much for watching.